joining us right now, and I think that he's written some really good pieces, and I actually mentioned this yesterday, and I wanted to bring him on. Kevin Roberts is the president of the Heritage Foundation. He's also an American history professor at UT. God bless you. Out at UT. I'm in Fort Worth, actually. So you're out in UT. God love you. And he also has his own podcast with the Heritage Network, The Kevin Roberts Show. Kevin, I appreciate you joining us on this because my big question, and because I know what I know and I know what I don't, which is why you're here to help shepherd us through this. I don't understand why they kept saying this has to be codified, etc. But we had the Obergefell decision, and I thought that had already established that state by state, no protections were going to be lost. This was something that every state had to adopt and every state acclimated to. So why are they pushing this?
Well, Dana, thanks for having me. But to the heart of your question, because in spite of everything that's going the wrong way in this country, I happen to think this is the worst thing because it cuts straight to the heart of the most important institution in humankind, and that is marriage between one man and one woman. But you ask a really important question that I've answered hundreds of times this week, as you might imagine, in Washington, D.C. And the answer is this: it's all a political agenda. And it's actually, in spite of its name, aimed at traditional marriage and aimed in particular at those of us who are people of faith, who, by the way, would never mistreat anyone. We love everybody, right? But some of us, I'm a faithful Catholic, have left a couple of Catholic institutions. Our church can never change that teaching. Why? Because it's scriptural. We do, however, live in America. We're a pluralistic country. We understand that some people disagree with that. Some people may even want to have a different marriage. Obergefell allows that to happen. And so there is no purpose for this bill. I just want to be really clear about one point, Dana. This bill does nothing that Obergefell did not already establish. And so, therefore, it is 100% about something else, and that something else is violating the religious liberty of all of us who deign to believe that marriage is between one man and one woman.
We're talking with Kevin Roberts, president of the Heritage Foundation and a professor in American history down at UT. And that's the kind of the big question because the way that in looking further into this, there was no protection at all whatsoever offered in the language of this legislation. Even though lawmakers could have added one, it's very telling that they purposefully chose not to for that purpose.
That's correct. You know, the ideal from our vantage point at Heritage, Dana, is that the bill not pass for reasons that are obvious to those of us who believe in traditional marriage. And even, let's say, if there are some thoughtful people who believe that Obergefell was the right decision, I would disagree respectfully. But even some of them say there's no reason to even be having this fight. You know, the advocates for same-sex marriage have gotten what they wanted. And so, therefore, that's the ideal. But then the backup position, if you will, by Heritage and many people in the conservative movement has been, if in fact you believe you need to pass this, even though we disagree with that, at least attach to the bill Senator Mike Lee's First Amendment Defense Act amendment. And what that would do is, in a very airtight way, enshrine the ability of Americans who disagree with the bill to still practice their faith. For organizations of faith who are providing services for adoption, for that matter, for immigrants, both legal and illegal, unfortunately, that they're still able to do their jobs even if their church believes in traditional marriage. Absent that amendment, Dana, to sum up here, this is going to be one of the most treacherous, insidious acts ever by the United States Congress. And that's why, even though we lost this cloture vote this week, the Heritage Foundation and our sister organization, Heritage Action, are fighting like hell to defeat it after Thanksgiving.
Now, that's amazing that I'm trying to figure out why a number of Republicans in the Senate voted for that. I know it was a procedural vote, but still, to progress it further along in the timeline of actually going to the floor for a final vote, that was kind of shocking to me. You mentioned the Mike Lee amendment. There was also, correct me if I'm wrong, Romney, Collins, Baldwin amendment, but that was getting a lot of flack for not actually providing a good enough defense. Tell me about the criticisms of that amendment that was offered by them.
The amendment is just pablum. I mean, it's nothing. And perhaps given, that's not a surprise, given the chief sponsor, Senator mm-hmm. Romney. And so I just want to be really clear. I do think that the only amendment for religious liberty that passes muster by Heritage, our lead scholar, Roger Severino, is the leading specialist, the leading expert in these questions, is Mike Lee's First Amendment Defense Amendment. And the reason is that it allows any organization, including those that are contracting services with the government to provide adoption services, services for the indigent, to be able to stay in business, even though they believe in traditional marriage. And so I'm gonna say this, and it's a little hopeful, and I don't believe in hollow optimism, so this is genuine. We believe there are five senators whose votes may be reconsidered after Thanksgiving, because we believe, giving them the benefit of the doubt, that because they're conservatives otherwise, that they went into voting for that procedural cloture thinking that they would get religious liberty provisions, and now they know they didn't. And so we believe that senators like Senator Capito in West Virginia, Senator Ernst in Iowa, Senator Lummis in Wyoming, Senator Sullivan in Alaska, Senator Young in Indiana, all thoughtful people, given the opportunity for their constituents to come to them and say, religious liberty is not protected by what you have allowed to proceed, change your vote. We think that perhaps over the Thanksgiving dinner table, they might change their minds.
You, I think you're providing a lesson here. You're way more grace giving about this than I am.
Very. Oh, Dana, right before I came on, I was texting with my wife, and we've been getting each other really fired up about this. I was president of a college of faith in Wyoming that beat Obama on the contraceptive mandate and then rejected federal student loans and grants because I could see this coming. So I've been in this battle for a long time.
Yes.
And they never stop. But I do have moments of being kind.
There you go. We're talking with Kevin Roberts with the Heritage Foundation, also American History, PhD professor in UT. You mentioned Roger Severino because I thought he gave, I think I listened to it. It was an interview that he had given. He was explaining kind of the rationale for how we got here, because the way that it seems is that the left saw what happened with Dobbs, and then they tried to take this remark, this concurrence from Justice Clarence Thomas, completely out of context, when he was talking about substantive due process. And saying he wasn't questioning the validity of enumerated rights, but he was questioning substantive due process, which is, you know, which we've seen the abuse from judges in numerous cases. And so they decided, I guess, to take that and say, well, if Dobbs can happen, then maybe something can happen to Obergefell. So this is why. But the argument is so specious, though. Tell us a little bit about this for those who haven't listened to Roger Severino's interview on this.
Well, there are a lot of scholars on both sides of the political spectrum who believe that what initiated this move to the misnamed Respect for Marriage Act was Justice Thomas's comment in the Dobbs decision about the same legal reasoning being applied to Obergefell. I understand from Roger, who's a very smart attorney, I'm just a historian, that makes a lot of sense. The chances of that politically, however, judicially, are close to zero. Why is that? Because culture's upstream from politics.
Right.
And I might lament that this country no longer believes that marriage is only between one man and one woman, but I accept as a proud American that I'm going to go through life and I'm going to fight upstream politics and upstream from the Supreme Court in culture, in my church, and in society, most of all, hopefully by being a good witness as a husband and a dad. But therefore, it's gonna be a really long time before we can confront that. It's specious because there is literally no attempt in any state legislature in the United States Congress to repeal, in effect, Obergefell. This is all about advancing the agenda and putting us on our heels. And I can tell you, to go back to your observation that for one moment I was being gracious, I can quickly not be gracious when I think about the reality that there are 12 Republicans in the Senate,
right,
and 47 Republicans in the House who voted for this garbage.
Yep. We're talking with Kevin Roberts. Last question for you. And this is, it might be kind of obvious, but when I look at how this particular piece of legislation doesn't actually even define what marriage is, it's the thing that gets me. Was it a mistake or maybe a mistake and then turned into, you know, a tactic by the left? Because they could have easily have said, if what they truly wanted was the recognition, legal or otherwise, of a contractual union agreement between two consenting adults. And then, you know, without fighting over who owns the word, marriage, which is you're making a statement before God. It is a religious action. So it's more than just a contractual agreement recognized by the state. But it's like their conflation seems to be a purposeful attempt to just stab at the heart of marriage and undermine that building block. And you're shaking. So that's your, I mean, you completely agree.
I 100%. I mean, as usual, you're spot on. And it not to sound too much like a broken record here, but I've lived this as president of Wyoming Catholic College when they were coming for us because we believed in traditional marriage. We were not going to buy into transgender ideology. Told them to go pound sand twice. And that college, by the way, has flourished as a result. So I've lived this personally at great cost, all of which is correct. They never stop. I mean, the best thing someone can do who's listening, trying to understand, is to read between the lines. And when you read between the lines, anytime the left is talking about same-sex marriage, they're really talking about undermining traditional marriage between one man and one woman. And very importantly, very relevant to this whole issue, Dana, religious liberty. They want religious institutions, your church, my church, your listeners' churches, to lose their tax-exempt status. And why is that? Because those churches adhere to truth with a capital T. And that is the ultimate target of the advocates of this bill.
And there you go. And I can see why it is the most concerning thing. And it's kind of shocking to me that there isn't more normal. I think 10 years ago, you'd see a lot of criticism about this. But with Twitter and Facebook and everything else, it seems to be an absence of it. I think that's a little concerning for me as it relates to the conservative movement, which I'm going to be talking about with David Harsanyi later on in the program, where that's going. Kevin Roberts with the Heritage Foundation. So appreciate your expertise and time today. Thank you so much. Have a happy Thanksgiving.
Thanks, Dana. You too.
Of course.